In the late 1890s here on Long Island, there was a man named Mile-A-Minute Murphy who claimed he could outrun a steam engine for a measured mile. A race was arranged, a lot of betting took place, and when a gun was fired, Murphy took off like a shot while the steam engine, lurching into first gear, started slow and took after him. This was a famous race. There were photographs taken of it at the time. And though there were some who said the engineer eased up on the throttle a bit as he started to catch Murphy at about the half-mile mark, the fact was that Murphy came across the finish line first, the steam engine huffing and puffing just a few yards behind. I thought about this recently when I was reading the manual for a 15-year-old laptop I have just bought on eBay. It could send email, slowly maybe, but nevertheless, it was one of the first laptops to be able to use email. I use email like everybody else these days. I have a state-of-the-art desktop, and here at Dan's Papers, we have all sorts of state-of-the-art desktops. Anyway, I wrote a story for this newspaper down at the beach on this old laptop, adjusted the email settings to 2400 baud, which by today's standards is painfully slow, typed the word internet in capital letters before I typed the email address so the machine would know it was going to send a message out on the internet, and then I pressed a button and emailed it in. I imagined this story flying over the dunes, going far away somewhere, maybe to North Dakota or Nebraska, then turning around and coming in for a landing on my computer up at the office in Bridgehampton Main Street. I imagined it as a biplane. I'm amazed you could get it to do that, our resident techie, Leif Neubauer, said when I got back to Dan's Papers. So am I said. I looked around the office. All this email was flying around at rocket speed. A thought occurred to me. Let's have a race. Here's what we did. Leif went down to the first floor and into the editorial room where he had what is probably the fastest computer in the establishment. I stayed upstairs in my office and clipped into a telephone line. What we would mail, both to my personal AOL account, was a file reading, I win. Leif would send his from his 750 megahertz high-speed cable-wired Mac G4 on the ground floor. I would send this same file from my old OmniBook 300 laptop, a machine with so few megahertz that you couldn't even measure them with a tweezers. Whichever of these emails would get to my AOL account first would win $10. Going to the desktop, I fired it up and opened AOL. We'd be able to see these two files come in for a landing, or so we thought. Next, we enlisted Barbara Maitland, the Dan's Papers art director, to be the starter. All you have to do, I told her, is stand at the foot of the stairs and shout as loud as you can so both Leif and I can hear you. Count us down. Can you do that? I can do that, she said. She stood at the bottom of the stairs, and calling to her and then having her call to Leif, we jockeyed our respective emails into position. I thought of Mile-A-Minute Murphy again. $10 is $10. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Go, Barbara shouted as loud as she could. At go, I pressed the button. Out at the front desk, I was told later, a man studying our ad rates stopped, his eyebrows raised, and stared at Barbara. What the hell was she doing? The planes were racing down their respective runways is what was happening. Well, mine wasn't exactly racing. Downstairs, I knew Leif's email had blown off the runway like an F-14 off the deck of an aircraft carrier. Up here, my computer was dialing the telephone, trying to make a hookup with the internet. I waited. Modem initialized, it said. Dialing, it said next. Then connection established, and finally sending file. There is that famous footage of Charles Lindbergh sitting in the cockpit of his Spirit of St. Louis, bumping down the dirt runway at Roosevelt Field on Long Island, trying to take off for Paris. He is loaded with fuel. The plane leaps up, drops down, touches the ground, does it a second time, then rises slowly up and just clears the telephone wires at the end of the runway. Thus was my email launched from an old CompuServe account bound for my AOL account. Whenever you receive an email, you may have noticed there is all this garbage at the top of it before you get to the message and indicating where the email has been routed as it has gone from the sender to you. They call this garbage headers. There are dates, times, codes, messages about receiving and sending, patching, networking, and switching. This is in many ways like the flight path tracked by air traffic controllers. If you ever wanted to know what route something took, you could. And if you ever wanted to know the times it arrived at certain places and went off to other places, you could know that too. For the next minute, I waited by my desktop, staring at AOL, looking to see the messages arrive. 2 minutes went by. Nothing happened. Leaf came bounding up the stairs, two at a time. "Maybe we have to turn it off and then turn it back on," I said. "Maybe," Leaf said. We turned it off and back on. The first of the messages had arrived. It was Leaf's. We waited another few minutes again, turning it off and on, and there was mine. "If you print them out," Leaf said, "we could read the headers." Here's what the headers told us. Both Leaf and I, hearing Barbara shout go, pressed the send button at exactly the same time, 2:36.26 p.m. There was no false start, and so 2:36.26 was our benchmark. It took Leaf exactly 4 seconds to get his message down the runway and up into the internet. Meanwhile, I was just getting into gear, bumping down the runway, dialing, connecting, spooling. At the 25-second mark, the control tower at AOL announced that it had Leaf coming in for a landing. 1 second after that, Leaf's message arrived on my AOL screen. My message at this point was still bumping along the runway trying to take off. It wasn't until the 27-second mark that my biplane finally left the ground, just barely clearing the telephone wires at the end of the runway. This was 1 second after Leaf's message had gone all the way to Nebraska and back to land successfully on my desktop. Leaf had already won. Anyway, my message now flew over the internet for 4 minutes and 14 seconds, after which time, with the pilot exhausted, it coasted in unsteadily to my AOL account on my desktop, arriving on my screen 1 second after that. Elapsed time since the starting line, 4 minutes and 15 seconds. I had finished second, a far distant second. Leaf and I went over the numbers for quite a while after that, trying to calculate the difference in the board speed to the difference in the time spent in the air by each message. If you're a girl, you can stop reading about here. This is guy stuff. It didn't quite work out, but it was close. If my biplane was limping along at 110 miles an hour, Leaf's jet streaked over at 3,000 miles an hour. That's what the ratio of the time difference told us. So I gave Leaf $10 and went back to work, and so did he. "Trusty little laptop, good job." I patted it on the head. "You work just fine on the beach, and sooner or later, the stories you send get to the cheering crowds in Paris just fine."